When I was about 4 to 6 years old, I would often go outside with my brother, mostly visiting the nearby forest. I remember one instance. Him and I came out of the forest and we were standing in front of rows upon rows of giant fields for farming. Now, because I was so little, I couldn't see the edges of those fields. I only saw what I saw and they seemed to go on forever. Over time, mostly due to inaccurate childhood memories, I formed this image in my mind of these fields that stretched on forever. Like the world was full of infinite opportunities, so vast and gigantic, full of places I would never be able to reach or explore, and which other people also could never explore. Something absolutely unobtainable. Recently, I looked on Google Maps. The fields weren't that big, obviously. I can imagine what they were for farming, and that meant that someone had to come by and maintain them. And that someone had places to go, places I could visit myself. And even if I didn't, I could easily imagine what they were like. Because I've been to places similar to them and they're nothing special. A couple years back, in 2013, CTF Well was glitched. You could jump on top of the invisible ceiling using stickies, which was shown to me by a random player. Not only that, but you could also get out of the map by walking over said ceiling and dropping down at the sides. I already loved Well as a map, so the thought of seeing it from a different angle while in-game excited me greatly. So I went demo, and then I jumped up there myself. At first, I was surprised, this actually worked! Then I was happy, then in awe, and then there was that feeling again. That feeling I felt back as a child. I was just standing there on the red base, looking at the blocky buildings and mountains in the distance, the train that sometimes came by, illuminated by the late afternoon sun. I honestly felt free and liberated. This was a place I should not be able to be, but here I was. I explored the map, looked at the trains, the buildings. I trolled people by killing them with stickies from above where they couldn't even see me. I even stood outside the fence, taunting at them, which made them stop dead in the tracks and ask me how I did that. Sometimes I would explain it, sometimes I wouldn't. I even had a random quick fix medic with me who came up there so I wouldn't die to fall damage. If you're watching this video right now, then I'd like to thank you for being there with me, buddy. It may not have meant much to you, but it did to me. Here's a very specific photo of him on one base and me on the other that really captures the freedom I felt. Just standing in this place I shouldn't be, looking over the giant skybox. That had been one of my fondest memories of TF2. Exploring maps had been a sort of hobby of mine back then. Just walking around in them, looking for places where I could film videos. One of those maps was Mountain Lab, which is simply one of the most beautiful maps designed in the game, and it really made me appreciate the world that TF2 takes place in. There was also Cold Front, which had the broken down car in the snow. It made me think about what caused it to break down, where the people that drove it went, what happened before and afterwards, and if they're okay. And then it made me think about what kind of location the map takes place in, and where I even was. I even ran around an empty Twofort, which I talked about in my Twofort video, as well as Dust Bowl. Sometimes I would even noclip into the skybox, but none of them compared to the feeling that I felt back on Well. You know the late Bob Ross, right? He's pretty beloved by many people, and for good reason. He taught them how to create fictional worlds through drawing on a canvas, with a high emphasis on nature. He was an incredibly skilled artist and had such a joy in painting that he wanted other people to experience that joy as well, kind of like the perfect art teacher. Now, an important property of canvases is that they're limited by their size. A trivial thing to point out, but it's probably one of my favorite features of the kinds of paintings that Bob Ross created. You see, the edge of a painting, to me, serves as not an end to the image, but rather as a way for you to imagine how it could keep going. Let me elaborate. Look at this painting. You see those mountains? Maybe, in the world of this painting, they actually stretch on forever. Maybe it's a world where towns, cars, even people don't exist. Or where Earth is neither a sphere, nor a plate, nor a cube, but an infinite space. Or maybe there's a McDonald's parking lot just out of frame. Who knows? You can't know, you can only imagine. But what I like to imagine is that what we see in the painting is the entire world. It's really hard to put into words, and it even kind of contradicts what I've been saying so far, since it's a feeling. What we see there in the painting, our limited view of the world, is all there is to it. You can't move past what you can see. It's a painting, and despite what Mario 64 and Dark Souls showed, you can't ever enter it. But it's not simply a rectangle floating in the void, because there is no void. There is nothing besides what we can see, yet at the same time, it's also infinite. It is something that we as humans cannot comprehend. Like when the Neverending Story described the nothing to me as a child. I just imagined it as that. Literally nothing. Something that you just cannot put into words. And that's what these edges represent to me. Not a limit, because there is no limit. There is only nothing. And that's also why I really love concept sketches, especially for environments like these. Because they are both finished, yet also never finished. It's a separate world, distant from whatever actually exists. Even if you entered that world, it just wouldn't be the same, it couldn't be. Because this separation, the fact that you can only see those few rough lines and shapes, and that you can't imagine anything besides them, that is what creates the magic. What more can you imagine when it comes to a concept? It would be like witnessing the Big Bang and then imagining Earth. You just can't do that because it is both a concept of infinite possibilities and also an isolated instance. I don't know if this really makes sense to any of you, so I'll try to explain it using a different example. Some people say that good horror movies and games are scary if you can see the monster or killer, because your mind fills in the blanks with your worst fears. However, I disagree. I don't think the unknown is scary because it lets you imagine the things you are most afraid of. I think the unknown itself is scary. The fact that you can't know. Even if your worst fear was clowns or spiders, the unknown would always be above that, since it is something so unreachable and unimaginable. It is simultaneously everywhere and nowhere at all. It can both be everything and nothing at the same time. It is so unpredictable and incomprehensible. Let's switch topics. Open world games like Skyrim boast about how you can travel anywhere and climb any mountain you see. You have complete freedom to do whatever you like. You are given the opportunity to be an explorer yourself. But then why? Why did those kinds of games never appeal to me? Why do I not really care for them? It is because I could reach those places. Even an infinite, randomly generated world like Minecraft just doesn't appeal to me like that, because you can theoretically, given enough time, see it all. What interests me more are skyboxes. Why? Because if I can reach something, it means that someone has quote-unquote been there already. Someone who placed that castle there, who placed enemies and loot and thought of a way for you to get them. Simply through the act of creating it, they explored it themselves. That, to me, removes the magic. Feelings really are difficult to put into words, you can only feel them, and they don't necessarily make sense. I guess if I could describe why I like those feels, those skyboxes, and those paintings created by Bob Ross, it would be because they are both unobtainable, yet hold infinite possibilities. Like, if I reached that place, which I never could, I would both have all the things I could ever want, yet also not at the same time because of how infinitely many there are. It's a contradiction between everything and nothing, kind of like our universe. It is infinite, perhaps filled with infinite stars, so you could go everywhere and experience things you've never seen before, but you also can't since it's so impossibly big. I suppose this wall that separates the place from what we have and what we can experience and imagine, namely our world, and the place that we can't reach, which is simultaneously everything and nothing, that is what fascinates me. You can't go inside a painting, you can't play in the skybox the same way you can in the regular map, and you can't walk to those fields. And even if you could, it would never be the same. And I think what made that moment on Well Back Then so special to me was the fact just how close I got to that wall. Simply the fact that I got closer than many other people, some of which were present to witness it, made me feel like myself back then as a child. Just standing there, next to my brother, overlooking those giant fields that seemed like they would go on forever. I would like to thank my patrons, specifically One True Ma, Alexis Chavez, Ben Isaacson, Charlie, Frozen Spaghetti, Oleg Andrev, Paulina Davidova, Pocket Pauling, Ren Marty, The Sad Boo, Zachary Leglerk, and unfortunately, not as always anymore, Xenomite. Thank you for deciding to support me and my channel, it really means a lot. And thank you very much for watching, have a wonderful day, and... Goodbye.